by building bridges and helping people how to live a healthier life, how to be free from lifestyle diseases, and find peace and happiness.
Working with people in the community, the center has held several health seminars and screenings in people's homes and yards. The center is offering computer and Spanish language classes. One popular program is the after-school homework program. Volunteer teachers work with small groups of students to improve their skills in subjects such as writing and math. This program gives children a place to go after school before their parents get home from work, where they can have a snack and get help with their homework. The volunteers like knowing that they could be making a lasting difference in the lives of these children.
And it is amazing, at least to me, the number of broken homes that are out there. And the children, you see them happy, you see them bubbly, but they come with all of that behind them.
I just love the art of helping children. And doing the psychology course, I remember learning that every single child needs to be listened to. Now, we would tend to all the different needs, and sometimes we tend to forget that they just need to be listened to.
The center also offers a counseling service for people in the community who are facing challenges in their lives. Nirupa has a degree in counseling and is the facilitator for counseling at the center.
A lot of people need help, and going through the rigors of daily living, family life, personal relationships, work life, there are a lot of stressors. And some, well, most, more than others, can't cope. And because of their ability to not cope, you have these problems coming out, and it affects other aspects of their lives.
Nirupa spends time at the center, talks with people in the community, and helps individuals cope with life's challenges.
And this is what counseling does. We help them identify the issues and how they can resolve them to live more enriched lives.
Please remember the Trinidad Life Hope Center and others like it around the world in your prayers as they reach out to help people in their communities.
The fact that you're there to be a role model for a child, and all children need grooming, and teaching is the best way to help a child to grow up into who he or she should be.
And so you can see, well, they say that learning brings about a change of behavior. And you can actually see that change of behavior from week to week. And you know that you're making a difference in their life.
God loves the people in the city. His power is sufficient for the countless millions in the urban areas. As you think of mission, pray specially for the work happening in the cities with 1 million plus citizens. Thank you for your support of mission.
You know, as the holidays approach, the stress level rises in individuals. And so noticing the centers that offer stress seminars, we are offering a stress seminar coming up this month on the 15th. We'll have a stress seminar right here. So invite your friends, come yourselves, and to help you find tools to cope with the stress, not only in your lives, but in other people's lives as well, to share. Let's pray to bring our Sabbath school to a close. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for the hope and the solace we find in knowing you. Father, we ask that the words that we learn in Sabbath school as we're studying James, that we may not be only hearers of the word, but also doers, O Lord. I pray, Father, that we may not keep those truths and those benefits to ourselves, but share with others as well. I pray for your Holy Spirit to be present here with us and with the speaker for today, that your word may reach our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. That was a beautiful song. Welcome this morning, and as we get ready to start our worship service and invite the Almighty God to worship with us as well, I want to draw your attention to some advertisements, so to speak, here. We have the annual Fall Festival coming up next weekend. That's November the 8th, so mark your calendars on that one. We also have, don't forget the Discover Revelation Speaks series on Tuesday. That's a very good series if you can make it. You'll get much of a blessing out of it. And then the midweek service the next day on Wednesday as well is Studying Christ Object Lessons. Also, we have a second reading for Barbara Whalen, transferring from Burlington, Iowa, SDA Church to St. Louis, West County, SDA Church. So all those in favor, make a motion. Okay, we got that. And then all those who want to welcome Barbara, raise your hand. All right, and I guess any opposed? All right, so welcome her to her new church. All right, with that, we will be getting started with our worship services here in just a little bit.
In Psalms 100, verse 4, enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. Have we not reason to be thankful every moment? Amen. Thankful even when there are apparent difficulties in our pathway. When you open your eyes in the morning, thank God that he has kept you through the night. Thank him for the breath of life. Thank him for his peace in your heart. Thank him for the angels, thousands upon thousands, guarding us against evil and pressing back the powers of darkness that are seeking to destroy us. Thank God for the smiles, for the hugs of our little ones. Let the fresh blessings of its new day awaken praise in our hearts for these tokens of his mercy and love. Morning, noon, and night, let gratitude as a sweet perfume ascend to heaven. For he is our maker and king. Let us rejoice, give thanks, and sing. Amen. Please sing with us on hymnal number
15.
Bless us, Lord, thy son.
Oh, Father in heaven, thank you so much that we can come today to meet with you, and help us all to have the fellowship that we should have, and forgive us of all our sins, and bless this service that is coming up. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right, if you will remain standing, our hymn of praise today is Give Me the Bible, page 272. The scripture reading for today comes out of 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 14 through 18. And that's 2 Corinthians chapter 6, 14 through 18. Be you not unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion has light with darkness? And what concord has Christ with Belial? Or what has part, excuse me, and what part hath he that believes with an infidel? And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God, and as God has said, I dwell in them that walk in them. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Therefore, come out from among them, and be, what saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, and will be a father unto you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. Sorry for that, I had a cold this week. Shall we kneel for prayer as we ask God to bless us?
Oh, Father in heaven, I thank you so much for this time to come together and worship with each other. And we come to you with our burdens, and we bring ourselves here to ask for answers to our prayers. I pray for those in this congregation who are sick, or those who have loved ones who are sick. And I pray for those who need healing spiritually and or mentally. And I pray that you will heal them today. And be with our speaker as he brings God's holy word to us. And thank you, Father, for Jesus' great sacrifice. He gave his all for us. And so help us to give our all, and help us to be merciful to those around us as we live in this world. And forgive us of all our sins. In Jesus' name, amen. Now we'll have the children's story by Kim Cardwell. So all the kids, please come forward. Okay, thanks. Okay, sorry about that.
Hi, everybody. I had to run up here from the piano, so my song was a little short. What do I have here? It's a thank you card, actually. It says thanks at the top, then it says, dear blank, thank you for the awesome blank. I love it. From blank. So, does anyone here have a thank you card? What did you write it for? Don't remember. Has anyone else written a thank you card? Has anyone ever gotten a thank you card? What did you get it for?
I don't remember.
Don't remember. Well, I was kind of hoping that Mrs. Havelke would be here, because if anyone knows Mrs. Havelke, they know that she's really good at writing thank you cards. Not too many people write thank you cards anymore, but it's really, really nice manners, don't you think? You can write thank you cards for, thank you for inviting me to your party, thank you for the socks that I got for Christmas, Grandma, or the new underwear. Thank you for my new bike, thank you for my new video game. All sorts of things we could be thankful for, right? So November is, what happens in November?
My birthday.
I think Riley knows in the back. Thanksgiving. So I'm sure you'll be learning in school about the pilgrims and the first Thanksgiving and all that stuff. But at Thanksgiving time, we give thanks to Jesus, right? And there's all sorts of things you could be thankful for. Can you think of anything you might be thankful for at Thanksgiving? No. How about thank you that I'm healthy? Thank you for my family. Thank you for my school. Thank you for the air that I breathe. Thank you for all of the blessings that you've given me. Do you have to write Jesus a thank you card? No. How can you say thank you to Jesus? Samira says. What else? You can also say thank you to Jesus by the way that we live, right? So you could say thank you to Jesus when you do something nice for somebody else. When you're kind to somebody else, maybe Jesus has given you a special gift, like you know how to do math really well. Maybe you could help somebody else learn that. Or maybe just by obeying. You know, I think that when in the Bible, Jesus says, if you love me, keep my commandments. And that's a way that we can show our love and thanks to Jesus every day. So let's think about the thank you cards we can give to Jesus through our lives. And let's make sure that our lives really say thanks for what we want to say thanks for and reflect really what's in our hearts. All right? You can go back to your seats. Thank you for coming up.
All right, the presentation of gifts today is for the local church budget. And it says this, Ellen White says this, the church is God's appointed agency for the salvation of men. It was organized for service, and its mission is to carry the gospel to the world. From the beginning, it has been God's plan that through his church shall be reflected to the world his fullness and his sufficiency. The members of the church are to show forth his glory, and the church is to be the repository of the riches of the grace of Christ. And through the church, and though the church will eventually be made manifest, even to the principles and powers in heavenly places, the final and full display of the love of God. So we see that our church has a mission here, and to turn the lights on and to do the things we need to do here costs money. And so today's offering is for the local church budget. So please give as God impresses you to give. Will the deacons please step forward? Dear Father, thank you so much for the jobs that we have and for the ability that we can support your work here in the St. Louis area, and help us to give. As you gave all, help us to do the same. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen.
You know, this this past month, and maybe this coming month too, some of you will be receiving phone calls from the nominating committee if you haven't already. And if you have received phone calls, I hope you said yes to most of the stuff you asked for. And if you haven't received phone calls, maybe you want to volunteer for something and you call them. And it could be that you say, oh good, I didn't get a phone call this year. But I'd like for you to rethink that and say this prayer with me that's in this song.
Gave me my hands to reach. show him your love and your perfect plan. You gave me my ears. I can hear your voice so clear. I can hear the cries of sinners, but can I wipe away their tears? You gave me my voice to speak your word, to sing all your praises to those who've never heard. But with my eyes I see more availability. I see hearts that have been broken, so many longing to be free. Lord, I'm available to you. Do what you say, do use me, Lord.
Thank you again for that, Chantal. That was very beautiful. And praise God for all the blessings that he gives to all each and every one of us. That I wish I could sing like that, but I don't have that in me. But I'm thankful other people do. Tom asked me, or emailed my wife, and she emailed that, sent it on to me. I didn't have as much time to prepare, but I hope what God has given me in the last week, that you'll find interesting and noteworthy for the time that we're living in today. How many of you think God is a tolerant being? I do. Okay? I'm going to give you three examples from the Bible that I would safe to say that he shows his to humanity already. First example I can think of is, where did sin start? In heaven. And the example that we have there is of Lucifer's rebellion in heaven. We don't know exactly how long that went on, but safe to say it went on long enough as far as God was concerned, and he had to put an end to it before everybody might have been swayed by Lucifer and to believing that God was wrong. But we all know God does not have an itchy trigger finger. He doesn't just do something out of whim. He gives patience, shows patience. The next example I could think of was of the flood. Sin occurred in the Garden of Eden, and the actions were taken by God. And since that time, we've seen sin grow through many different actions, where God was not happy with humanity and thought about maybe wiping out humanity. But he saw favor in Noah. And it was, according to my timeline in my Bible, it was 1,656 years from the time of sin started till the flood came. And 120 years, of course, the last 120 years, Noah preached. I'm sure he preached every day for the salvation of mankind to get on that ark. And we know how that turned out. And then the last example I can think of is when the Israelites were coming back from captivity and they were given the declaration in 457 BC by Artaxerxes to rebuild the temple. And the prophecy stated that they were given 490 years until the coming of the Messiah and his ministry. And to humble themselves and receive God's messenger, their Savior. And we know how that turned out too. So you can see how tolerant and merciful God has been to all of his creation. He truly is the God of patience. So what's with my title? Beware of the tolerant. Sounds a little weird, doesn't it? Well, if you've been made aware of in this society we live in today, tolerance is quite talked about in a different manner than what godly tolerance has been. Basically, for the last 50 to 100 years, it has been growing, and especially the last 25 years, it's really kind of coming to a head. And I wanted to share some definitions from my Webster's Dictionary of what tolerance means is according to people who think they know what it means. It says being one example is respecting the being and respecting and having tolerance for others' beliefs and practices. Another one is to recognize and respect others' beliefs and practices without sharing them. And another is to bear or to put up with someone or something not especially liked. Okay, I know I have a hard time with that one myself. I'm sure some of you do too. But also is the last one, which is the one I'm really going to focus on, is freedom to hold religious views that differ from the established ones. This one is being challenged in today's society. Christian beliefs and values are being spoken of as intolerant. We're not showing tolerance for those people out there that believe it's okay to be gay and be married. I'm not sure if you realize this, but just recently the Supreme Court struck down 5 states who had laws against that. And they said they were unconstitutional. Now, it was a 5-4 vote. It was a close vote. But now there are 30 states that allow gay marriage or are allowed to have gay marriage. That's over half of the states. I pointed this out to my son the other day when I was writing my, when Obama took office, there was only 7. So it's increased by quite a bit. And when I had Pastor Olin over at my house the other day, he spoke of something, a story he told me about the mayor of Houston, Texas, who just happens to be a gay woman, was worried about the pastors speaking against it, so she was subpoenaing pastors for their notes to their sermons to see how they viewed that issue. Who's being intolerant? Have you ever seen these bumper stickers that say coexist? Well, there's another one that says tolerance and peace and some other things. I'm not sure if you're aware of this, but each and every one of those symbols used to spell out those words represents an occultic satanic meaning. So they're not really what they claim to be. And in a few years ago, the UN came out with a document entitled The Declaration of the Principles of Tolerance. So the UN is trying to tell us what tolerance is. And this is an excerpt from it. It says, tolerance is the responsibility that upholds human rights, pluralism, democracy, and the rule of law. It involves the rejection of dogmatism and absolutism and affirms the standards set out in international human rights instruments. It also means that one's views are not to be imposed on others. So if we go out to evangelize some people and bring the truth to them, that is not being tolerant, according to what the UN is saying here. And does anybody know what pluralism means? It's kind of like everybody to get along in one big happy family of around this earth, that, you know, we aren't going to have any differences against anything. And dogmatism, some things say, but I looked it up in my dictionary, and dogma is also another name for dogma is doctrine. We have doctrine in God's word, don't we? That we are to uphold because they are the teachings of God. And absolutism, what in the word of God is absolute? Well, we're doing it today. It's to keep the Sabbath holy, isn't it? And that's a dividing factor in today's Christianity. Because today, it doesn't matter, according to most people, what day you keep. But especially not the Sabbath. And we know that's going to be the issue in the end times, of what day to worship on. So we have to be tolerant of everything, but in today's society, they are not tolerant of our views. And that's a big issue, especially as we get closer and closer to the end of time. This was another thing. It happened in 1999 when they had an interfaith ecumenical meeting. Pope John Paul II was there. And this consensus of people there from all different religions and faiths, they deemed him to be the planet's chief spiritual guide and overseer. They also endorsed a couple of his statements that he said religious fundamentalists who refuse to go along with the global ecumenical movement are to be silenced. He also said they must be denounced as dangerous extremists full of hate. Fundamentalism, what is fundamentalism? Yes? Go ahead. It's us, yeah, that's true, it's us. In a sense, it's a strong belief you have other religious extremists as in some ways, but we are going to be as believing in God and sola scriptura, we will be the religious fundamentalist at the end times because we're not going to compromise our beliefs. And I'll go farther and I'll state as what God said, Jesus himself said in John chapter 16, if you want to turn there, John chapter 16, verses 1 through 4. These are the words of Jesus. And he said, "These things I have spoken unto you, that ye shall not be offended. Ye should not be offended. They shall put you out of the synagogues. Yea, the time cometh that whosoever killeth you will think that they doeth God service. And these things will they do unto you because they have not known the Father nor me. But these things have I told you that when the time shall come, ye may remember that I told you of them, and that these things I said not unto you at the beginning because I was with you." So this is not something should be a surprise and we should be alarmed about. We know this is to take place. This is something that has been told from centuries past. I didn't have time to put this, but I wanted to make mention that there was an ex-New Ager who became a Christian, and he basically states the New Age have the plans, and they probably already have it in place now by now, to have these relocation centers or re-education centers, as they're called them, for anybody who does not have the beliefs that they have. And we know we've seen these in the past, haven't we? We saw them in World War II. The Jews were, and the Japanese here in America were their concentration camps, their death camps, basically. Some of us are going to end up there. Hopefully not all of us, because we'll get to the wilderness, but some of us may end up there. And I pray that we will not renounce what we have seen today and know today to be true. There's been a global movement going on for many years now to unite all the governments and economies and religions together, except, of course, God's faithful, into one. And we know, of course, the Pope is to head this organization. But did you know that the New Age has been attempting to unify the world's religions since 1893 in Chicago? They had their first meeting right here in the United States in Chicago. The first interfaith ecumenical conference they had. All the world's religions. Not talked about too much. But it happened. You can find it and you can look it up. The Bible calls this religious group at the end time what? Babylon. right? Confusion. And one of the New Age leaders, I found this on a website, one of the New Age leaders named Thomas Ehrenzeller, he said this: a growing number of people are sponsoring a backlash against the wave of religious fundamental fanaticism. The right course to take is that which will lead to a new world of unity and world law. Thus, the expressed aims and efforts of the UN will be eventually brought to fruition, and a new church of God, gathered out of all the religions and spiritual groups, will unitedly bring to an end the great heresy of separateness. Now notice that. Separateness is a heresy. Love, unity, and the risen Christ will be present, and he will demonstrate to us the perfect life. Hasn't that already taken place? But these people are waiting for their Christ still. I don't know if you know the name they use. It's called Maitreya. Okay, and they call it the cosmic Christ. But I have a little side note. I didn't put this in my notes, but I thought about it if I had time to say it. But did you know that the Roman Catholic Church has two observatories looking out in outer space for the coming Christ? They have one in Italy, north of Rome, in the mountains. And they have another one here in the United States, outside of Tucson, Arizona. Do you know what they call their telescope? It's an acronym. Lucifer. That's the name of the telescope. But as we read, as Mark read in 2 Corinthians 6:17, he says, come out of her, right, my people, and be ye separate. So it's a difference of what the world says than what God says. And who are we to follow? We are to follow what God says, because God knows best, right? He's the one that created us. He knows the end from the beginning. And he knows what's coming. There are two things that these New Age leaders want to have, and they say they must happen. One is the population of the world must be reduced, and they also must eliminate anything that is defective. And I'll get to that point, but I'll follow the first one, the population reduction. I don't know if you've ever heard of this thing. You ever heard of the Georgia Guidestones? Anybody ever heard of the Georgia Guidestones? Okay, they're in Georgia. Somebody erected them. They're made out of granite, and they're called America's Stonehenge. You know what Stonehenge is, okay? They're called America's Stonehenge, but they're called the Georgia Guidestones. They have 10 different guides on them, or principles, okay? And they're written in 8 different languages. So it's a good-sized structure, because each one, there's 8 of them, okay? And they're pretty good size. You can read it from a distance. Okay, and I'll just give you the first couple ones, because that's all the article I saw said. The first one says, the first guide that says on there, actually, let me tell you, it's 10 guides for humanity for those who survive the apocalyptic world. Okay, so they know that strife is coming to this world. They know that there's going to be rumors of war and wars and that. They know this. Okay? The first guide, they say, is to maintain humanity under 500 million in perpetual balance with nature. How many people do we have on this earth right now? It's nearing 8 billion, I've heard, the latest. 500 million. Think about that. The second supports the first guide. It says society needs to guide reproduction wisely. So these people are definitely for what? Abortion? Probably. But it doesn't say, you know, it doesn't tell us how they're going to reduce the population and who gets to live. And there's one man who knows who erected this or who built it, you know, as far as who paid for it, and he's not talking. That's what the article said. Obviously, he's probably somebody of good wealth. I couldn't have done it. I don't have that money. Some of the other people that, you know Ted Turner, founder of CNN. He said a total world population of 250 to 300 million people would be ideal. That's a 95% reduction in what we have. And he made the statement, of course, he's famous for Christianity is for bozos. I don't know if you ever knew. I grew up with Bozo the Clown. Okay, so that's what he's talking. He's calling people who like to be Christians clowns. Another one who's a famous person, Prince Philip of England, he said this about the population. He says, in the event I am reincarnated, I would like to return as a deadly virus in order to contribute something to solve overpopulation. Are these people happy to have people alive and well? And are they thinking for themselves? Another famous New Ager, Barbara Marks Hubbard, I don't know if some of you might remember that she ran as a vice presidential candidate in 1984. She said this about Christians. There have always been defective seeds. In the past, they were permitted to die a natural death. We, the elders, have been patiently waiting until the very last moment before the quantum transformation to take action to cut out this corrupted and corrupting element in the body of humanity. It is like watching a cancer grow. Something must be done before the whole body is destroyed. So now we are cancer cells. I could go on a lot of things, but I don't, you know, we have time but there's so much that I could have added. And I just wanted to, you know, state in the end here, I hope you're starting to see just how serious it is getting before Jesus is coming. Just how much maybe time we don't have left in this world to get out the message, to get people inspired to follow in God's footsteps. And I hope is in some ways inspires you. I want to read from Matthew chapter 24. As I've always enjoyed the chapter, even though it doesn't start out so well, but you know, it does have, to me, a better ending. But it does, in many ways, I like what God said, the very first thing Christ said to his followers, his disciples. Starting in verse 3, he says, as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us, when shall all these things be, and what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? And Jesus answers and said unto them, take heed that no man deceives you. The very first thing God says to them, doesn't say, before he says anything else, says, take heed that you will not be deceived. Brothers and sisters, there are many people who are deceived, even sitting in churches today, about what's coming. And we have to decide and make decisions about what we're going to do about these things. Verse 5, he says, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. So Christ told us from the very beginning of his ministry that these things must take place. It's not something that we should be alarmed and shocked by. No, do we want to see it happen, but it's prophesied, in a sense. It has to happen. But don't worry. I overcame the world, God said. You can too. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines, pestilences. Don't we have that going on right now? I mean, I saw on 3ABN last Sabbath, it was. I watched a thing on 3ABN about the Ebola thing going on. The two Adventist young doctors that were over there in treating people in Liberia, they were just like, this is getting overblown, this Ebola thing. There's a lot more people out there dying of other things than Ebola. It's being blown out of proportions. And she said that the one young lady, she's a single doctor in her late 20s, but she said, Americans shouldn't be worried about this so much. If anything, you should be thankful you're in America because you're safer. And you have probably better treatment than a lot of these people over there. Verse 8 says, all these things are beginning of sorrows. And then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted and shall kill you, and you shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. And then shall many be offended and say, and shall be betray one another and shall hate one another. And many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. But he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. Brothers and sisters, I hope that last verse there, you want to endure to the end. You don't want to be afraid. I came here today with a heavy heart, okay? I want you to pray for my son. The devil has got my son right now. And he's not letting go of him. He had a meltdown this morning. And that's why my wife and I mean, I almost didn't come, but my wife said, you got to go. This is personal. My son really wanted to be here today. He wanted to hear this. I wanted him to hear it. Jesus is coming back. Praise the Lord. And if you want to be one of those people that Jesus is coming back for, we got to read the Bible correctly so we will not be deceived. Out of love for Jesus, remember that the Holy Spirit will guide you into all truth, as the Bible says. And out of love for Jesus, who is the truth, the way, and the life, let us be obedient and endure to the end. Let us sing our closing hymn, Trust and Obey. Number 590.